Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Reconstruction of Nations, Poland, Ukraine, Lithuania, Belarus, 1569 to 1999, by Timothy Snyder, narrated by Rich Miller. Introduction. When do nations arise? What brings ethnic cleansing? And how can states reconcile? This study traces one passage to modern nationhood. It begins with the foundation of the largest realm of early modern Europe, the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, in the 16th century. The nation of this commonwealth was its nobility, Catholic, Orthodox, and Protestant. United by common political and civil rights, nobles of Polish, Lithuanian, and East Slavic origin alike describe themselves, in Latin or Polish, as of the Polish nation. They took for granted that, in the natural order of things, the languages of state, speech, literature, and liturgy would vary. After the Commonwealth's partition by rival empires in the 18th century, some patriots recast the nation as the people, and nationality as the language they spoke. At the end of the 20th century, as this study closes, the core lands of the old Commonwealth were divided among states named after nations: Poland, Ukraine, Lithuania, and Belarus. By then, the prevailing conception of nationality expected state borders to confine linguistic communities, and the languages of speech, politics, and worship to be the same. How did four modern national ideas arise from a single early modern one? Our route through this passage follows the national ideas of the early modern Commonwealth, 1569 to 1795, of the 19th century empires that partitioned it, 1795 to 1918, and of the independent states and Soviet republics that supplanted them, 1918 to 1939. We will find that the early modern Polish nation survived partition and prospered under empire, its disintegration beginning in the late 19th century. Even then, modern national ideas emerged in intimate competition with this early modern vision, against a more distant backdrop of imperial rule. This close contest between traditional patriotism and ethnic nationalism continued in the new polities established after the First World War. Although statehood itself forced choices and closed options after 1918, the newly privileged idea of the modern ethnic nation was not yet hegemonic. Only the organized violence of the Second World War finally broke the historical integument in which early modern ideas of nationality could cohere. Deportations, genocide, and ethnic cleansing destroyed historical regions and emptied multicultural cities, clearing the way for modern nationalism. The mass murder and displacement of elites uprooted traditions. In advancing this claim, this study concentrates upon the wartime experience of Poles and Ukrainians and inquires about the causes of their mutual ethnic cleansing. After 4 years of Soviet and Nazi occupation, Ukrainians and Poles ethnically cleansed each other for four more. These cleansings claimed more than 100,000 lives and forced 1.4 million resettlements. How did this come to pass? Is ethnic cleansing caused by nationalism, or does ethnic cleansing nationalize populations? Can nation-states come to terms with such history? Can the demands of modern national ideas, so brutally expressed by ethnic cleansing, find a peaceful articulation? These are the questions posed by the 1940s to the 1990s. In the years following the revolutions of 1989, every imaginable cause of national conflict could be found among Poland, Lithuania, Belarus, and Ukraine. Imperial disintegration. Frontiers without historical legitimacy. Provocative minorities. Revanchist claims. Fearful elites. Newly democratic politics. Memories of ethnic cleansing, and national myths of eternal conflict. From these beginnings, a Polish Eastern policy aware of modern nationality fashioned a stable geopolitical order. The collapse of the Soviet Union was anticipated, hastened, and turned to peaceful ends. The simplest evidence of Polish success was Western ignorance of the historical rivalries and wartime cleansings that this book will describe. Where there was armed conflict in the 1990s, as in Yugoslavia, the public learned of wartime precedents and supposedly ancient hatreds. Where peace and prosperity prevailed, as in Poland, the historical narrative of the return to Europe took center stage. Another proof of the success of Poland's Eastern policy was precisely Poland's Western integration. 1999 witnessed a startling juxtaposition of success and failure in the new Europe. As NATO admitted Poland, it bombed Yugoslavia. As the world followed conflicts among Serbs and their neighbors, a joint Polish-Ukrainian peacekeeping battalion was dispatched to Kosovo. Why did northeastern Europe come together as southeastern Europe fell apart? Time. These three questions, when modern nations arise, why ethnic cleansing takes place, how nation-states make peace, suggest the chronological range of this study, 1569 to 1999. 1569 marks the creation of the early modern Polish nation. In that year, the Polish and Lithuanian nobility established their commonwealth by an agreement known as the Lublin Union. Henceforth, Lithuanian and Polish nobles were together represented in a single parliament, jointly elected monarchs, and increasingly shared a common civilization. The Polish kingdom and the Grand Duchy of Lithuania retained separate codes of law and administrations, and an internal border. The Lublin Union altered this frontier to Poland's advantage, transferring Lithuania's more southerly East Slavic lands to Poland. This divided East Slavic nobles and peoples, creating a new border between what we now call Ukraine and Belarus. The Lublin Union, although issued in a spirit of religious toleration, coincided with ambitious church reform. Conversions of East Slavic gentry from Eastern to Western Christianity created a new difference between nobility and commoners in the lands we now call Belarus and Ukraine. Thus, the unification of a Polish noble nation was accompanied by new divisions among other social orders. The rebellion in Ukraine that followed in 1648 provided the contours of Polish, Ukrainian, and indeed Russian national history. 1569 is an untraditional starting point. National histories of Poland, Lithuania, Belarus, Ukraine, or Russia usually begin with the medieval period and trace the purportedly continuous development of the nation to the present. To recognize change, it is best to accept the unmistakable appearance of a single early modern nation in the vast territories of the early modern Commonwealth, then consider its legacies to modern politics. This early modern nation was called Polish, but the term signified citizenship and civilization rather than language or ethnicity. Beginning with 1569 allows us to see the coherence and appeal of the early modern Polish nation, and to liberate ourselves from our own modern assumptions about what nationality must entail. Since this is a study of nationality rather than statehood, its intermediate caesurae are also unconventional. The 19th century was the beautiful age of Polish civilization, even though the Commonwealth had been partitioned in 1795. Rather than dwelling on 1795, as romantic, national, and historiographical tradition all recommend, this book regards 1863 as the beginning of the end of early modern politics. In 1863, Polish nobles rebelled one last time against Russian rule. After 1863, the Russian Empire began to challenge Polish cultural and economic dominance in its Western domains. After the uprising, important sections of the traditional Polish elite turned against traditional definitions of the polity and the nation. They were joined by a few imperial administrators and folk activists, who proposed that nations were defined by religion and language. Only after 1863 do we see modern Polish, Lithuanian, and Russian nationalisms hostile to the early modern inheritance and the hint of a Belarusian idea. There was no such rupture in the small portion of the old Commonwealth taken by Austria. Here we shall concentrate on 1876. In that year, Ukrainian publications were banned in the Russian Empire. Henceforth, the Ukrainian idea in Austria began to gather force, and the conditions for the Ukrainian-Polish rivalry in Austrian Galicia were put in place. We shall see that the past does matter in the rise of modern nations, but not in the ways that these new modern nationalists would claim. Every modern nationalism we encounter will ignore palpable early modern traditions in favor of imagined medieval continuities. We will also find that modernization is linked to nationalism, even if theories of modernization cannot explain the essential particulars of national success and failure. The features of modern society, political ideologies, democratic politics, refined propaganda, mass media, public education, population growth, urbanization, industrialization, all take their place in this study. The centralized state is something of a fetish both of nationalists, who project it back into the past, and of social scientists, who properly emphasize its novelty and potential, but sometimes exaggerate the success of state builders. States, no less than nations, exist in time. State power is legitimate when people find it to be so. In this study, attempts to build modern centralized states are seen as projects with mixed and often unanticipated results. States are destroyed as well as created, the manner of their destruction often determining the national ideas of the next generation. When created, states often take ambiguous forms. For example, early Soviet republics with changing nationality policies, where national renaissance is followed by the mass murder of the intelligentsia thus exposed. An ambitious interwar Poland divided about the definition of the nation, able neither to assimilate the borderlands nor to build a federal structure. Or a post-war Polish state legitimated by ethnic homogeneity but governed by communists. In its treatment of the first decades of the 20th century, the book is concerned with state building as one experience, among others, that helped or hindered national ideas. In the middle of the 20th century, centralized states of a particular kind, Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union, occupied all of the territories with which this book is concerned. The systems they imported were hostile to the peoples who fell under their domain, and foreign to traditional methods of local politics. While attending to the establishment, or not, of nation-states, or their simulacra, after the First World War, this study thus attaches more importance to the fate of peoples during the Second. The Second World War battered the remnants of early modern nationality and spread modern nationalism far and wide. Although both are intermediate caesurae, 1945 is thus more important than 1918. After 1863, modern national ideas embraced the mass population. After 1945, mass populations embraced modern national ideas. For similar reasons, the study ends in 1999 rather than 1989. Although Poland regained sovereignty in 1989, and Belarus, Lithuania, and Ukraine gained independence in 1991, it is Poland's accession to NATO in 1999 that suggests the end of a stage of national history. NATO membership not only confirmed the success of a modern Polish nation-state, it rewarded Poland's handling of sensitive national questions. In supporting the new nation-states between itself and Russia, Poland succeeded in defining itself as part of the West. 1569 marked an early modern Polish commitment to Eastern expansion that ended in the 1940s. 1999 marked a novel Polish commitment to a Western security and political identity. Territory. Rather than follow the borders of 20th century nation-states or 19th century empires, this study considers lands of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth as constituted in 1569. Part 1 concentrates on the city of Vilnius. Vilnius was the capital of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, a provincial capital within the Russian Empire, a Polish city in the 1920s and 1930s, and a Soviet-Lithuanian city after the Second World War. It is today the capital of independent Lithuania. Before the Final Solution, Jews called Vilnius the Jerusalem of the North. Until very recently, the city was claimed by Poles, Russians, and Belarusians as well as Lithuanians. Within an early modern framework of political nationality, Vilnius is a Lithuanian city, since it was the capital of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania within the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. Within a modern framework, Vilnius is anything but a Lithuanian city before the Second World War. Very few of its inhabitants were Lithuanians, and it was part of the Polish state. Thus, our concern here is how the city became Lithuanian in a modern national sense, in population and culture. Part 2 focuses on Eastern Galicia and Volhynia. These East Slavic territories, inhabited by large Polish and Jewish populations, were heartlands of the old Commonwealth and imperial hinterlands after its demise. In the partitions of the late 18th century, Volhynia fell to Russia and Galicia to Austria. As in historic Lithuania, in Galicia and Volhynia, Poles remained the dominant element throughout the 19th century. Only at century's end did Polish landlords give ground to Russian rivals in Volhynia or compromise with Ukrainian political parties in Austrian Galicia. In both empires, Polish nationalists helped the Ukrainian cause by degrading Polish nationality. The early modern Polish nation was a matter of associating oneself with the impressive attainments of a civilization that operated in Polish. By relocating the nation in the people, Polish nationalists redefined the Poles as one ethnic group among others and invited competition on the level playing field of the illiterate peasantry. After the First World War, both Galicia and Volhynia were absorbed by a new Polish state. Although interwar Poland's indecisive policies aided Ukrainian nationalists, the early 20th century in Galicia and Volhynia was very similar to the 19th or even the 18th. Only the Second World War destroyed the historical integrity of Galicia and Volhynia and brought the triumph of modern nationalism. These lands were joined in 1945 to Soviet Ukraine, and since 1991 have been the most patriotic regions of independent Ukraine. Today they are known as Western Ukraine. A tight geographical focus on Vilnius, for Poland, Lithuania, Belarus, and Galicia and Volhynia, for Poland, Ukraine, over the longue durée is a means of clarifying these transformations. If we fix our gaze upon historical regions over the course of four centuries, we can register economic and social change, see armies pass back and forth, and in the 20th century, observe peoples exterminated, deported, and resettled. If we can stand to stand still, if we are moved without moving, we recognize painful and definite change. We can watch the political landscape shift, rupture, and finally resolve itself into something new. In recognition of the transformations of the 1940s, the third part of this book concentrates not so much on the Vilnius, Galicia, and Volhynia, as on the diplomatic problems they posed for newly sovereign nation-states after the revolutions of 1989. Part 3 discusses a Polish grand strategy of the 1990s that accepted and confirmed the division of Eastern Europe into nation-states within present borders. That may appear straightforward, but it was an innovation in Polish political theory and unusual in the practice of East European diplomacy after the end of communism. Jews, Russians, Germans? When the statue of Lenin in the Galician town of Kolomia was dismantled, its pedestal was seen to be constructed from Jewish tombstones. Kolomia, today, is a town in southwestern Ukraine. In 1939-41 and 1945-91, it was a town in southwestern Soviet Ukraine. Between 1941 and 1944, a town in the Nazi Generalgouvernement. Before the Second World War, a town in Poland's Stanisławów province. Before the First World War, a town in Austrian Galicia. before 1772, a town in the Polish kingdom's Ruthenian province. Until the final solution of 1941-42, Kolomia was, whatever its rulers, a Jewish town. The absence of Jews, in Kolomia as throughout Eastern Europe, coincided for 40 years with the presence of communist rule. The 1990s brought an explosion of national history in Eastern Europe, but new research often began from the national world inherited from the Second World War and codified by communists. Jewish history has been separated from the mainstream of East European history. Just as Israeli historiography emphasizes the successful Zionist project, neglecting the East European origins of Israeli politics, so East European historiographies concentrate on statehood, often failing to give the Jews their due place. There are numerous worthy exceptions, and a recent laudable trend to publish edited volumes featuring multiple national points of view. Although this is immensely useful, it does not resolve the problem of nationalism in history. It can lead to a politically correct multinationalism, in which parallel national canals are cut through historical ground that requires careful irrigation. Given the scope of this work, why are Jews, Germans, and Russians omitted from its subtitle? This is a study of modern Polish, Ukrainian, Lithuanian, and Belarusian nationality, with no ambition to follow German, Russian, or Jewish nationality to contemporary conclusions. This is humility, not neglect. The main lines of German national history lead elsewhere. The Russian national idea is treated here in its connection with early modern Ukraine and Lithuania. For five reasons, the emergence of the Jewish national idea must await a separate treatment. First, the Jews are an older historical community than the Slavic and Baltic nations. Second, the communal autonomy of Jews in the old Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, the necessary introduction to this subject, escapes our structure here. Third, the Jews' gateway into modern political life was the abolition of community privileges and legal separation characteristic of the Commonwealth, and the slow and incomplete extension of individual rights by the partitioning empires during the 19th century. This experience is sufficiently different from the restorationist national politics of Gentiles to require separate attention. Fourth, 20th century territorial nationalism aspiring to repartition the old Commonwealth into nation-states was never an option for the Jews. Finally, the relationship between the Shoah and the State of Israel, although it reinforces a major argument of this book, would draw us away from the East European territorial focus that serves as its method. There will be commonalities and convergences. And yet the periodization and argumentation of a proper history of Jewish nationality requires a different sort of reconstruction than this. While it does not aspire to treat Russian, German, and Jewish national history, this study does contend that Polish, Ukrainian, Lithuanian, and Belarusian national history is unintelligible without the Russians, Germans, and Jews. A particular effort is made to present a unified history of the Second World War, subsuming what are sometimes treated as separate subjects. The final solution is integrated here into the wartime and post-war history of Eastern Europe. We shall see that the extermination of Vilnius Jews in 1941-44 and the expulsion of Vilnius Poles in 1944-46 were conditions for the post-war construction of a Soviet-Lithuanian Vilnius. We will find that the Volinian Holocaust of 1942 trained the young men who began the slaughter of Volinian Poles in 1943. Soviet violence, too, finds its place. In the context of ongoing Ukrainian-Polish ethnic cleansing, Soviet nationality policy was changed by its application to Polish territories in 1944. Polish communists, aided directly by Soviet forces and indirectly by Polish nationalists, completed a project of national homogenization in 1947. Withal, we observe the lines of continuity, from the final solution to partisan cleansings to communist cleansings to the establishment of communist rule. This study draws gratefully upon contemporary East European historiography. It seeks, however, to present national history in a particular framework. It treats multiple national questions rather than creating or revising a single national narrative. It moves forward rather than backward in time, seeking to avoid the projection of later political forms upon earlier periods. Its gaze is focused upon defined places, so that changes in national ideas, movements, and claims are seen for what they are. It defines early modern or hybrid ideas of nationality that a modern scholar may find alien. It takes note of accidents, contingencies, and luck. It treats national failures, for example, Belarus, as attentively as national successes, since they convey just as much about what modern nationality requires for political success. It portrays national heroes in the context of the early modern ideas of nationality they contemplated, adapted, or rejected. It reconsiders ideological oppositions, as between nationalism and communism. These general aims are accepted by a number of historians of and in Eastern Europe. I claim no originality in specifying them, only an ambition to write within the framework they define. The debt to previous historiography is greatest in chapters 1 through 7, although they offer some new interpretations. The argument that Romanticism served both early modern and modern ideas of nationality under imperial rule, in nation-states, and in the Soviet Union may be an innovation. The systematic investigation of the Belarusian national failure in the context of the successes of other national movements is, as far as I know, unprecedented. The sustained effort to explain the Lithuanization of Vilnius is, to my knowledge, the first of its kind. Chapters 8 through 14 rely on archival and other primary source research, and present not only new arguments but little-known events. Chapters 8 through 10 provide the first scholarly treatment in English of the totality of Ukrainian-Polish ethnic cleansing between 1943 and 1947. Chapters 11 through 14 connect a Polish grand strategy elaborated in the 1970s, a Polish Eastern policy implemented in the early 1990s, and Polish success in European integration. While there are numerous studies of the collapse of Yugoslavia and southeastern Europe, these four chapters present the first treatment of the stabilization by Poland of northeastern Europe. As a whole, this study unifies the early modern Polish nation and its multiple modern successors. Only by crossing conventional divides, such as that between Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union, or that between the Russian and Austrian empires, can we chart the passage from early modern to modern nationality? Myths and metahistories. In presenting a new view of East European history, this study rarely polemicizes with national myths. There are, for example, mature and hardened Lithuanian and Polish discourses about what happened when Polish troops seized Vilnius in 1920. Just as there are opposed Ukrainian and Polish versions of the ethnic cleansing of Volhynia in 1943. Each party to such national disputes advances important arguments, but both sides taken together do not provide everything that an outsider would wish to know. Compromise among competing national myths is certainly important in diplomacy, but does not provide the historian a way forward. No amount of compromise can generate independence, and the historian must work within an independent framework. While no one would claim that any framework eliminates politics, there is a clear difference between building a scholarly apparatus and taking on national myths. Refuting a myth is dancing with a skeleton. One finds it hard to disengage from the deceptively lithe embrace once the music has begun, and one soon realizes that one's own steps are what is keeping the old bones in motion. It is easy to be captured by the choreography of myth-making and breaking, and hard afterwards to regain one's own rhythm. The musty smell lingers for some time, too. By the same token, this book does not dwell on the great 19th-century national schemes of history that organize so much historical discussion in our own day. Poles, for example, colloquially refer to the early modern Commonwealth as Polish, meaning that it was something like a modern Polish state. Russians imagine that the centuries that East Slavic lands spent within the Commonwealth are a meaningless prelude to their reunification with Russia. These views are meta-historical, a long word that here means not even wrong. Their popularity inspires their opponents to turn them on their heads. Lithuanians can demonstrate that medieval Vilnius was not Polish, but Lithuanian. Or Ukrainians can prove that they, not Russia, inherited Kievan civilization. To argue with meta-history risks accepting its rules of engagement, and nonsense turned on its head remains nonsense. There are no syntheses to be found there, only theses and antitheses. Dialectics of myth and meta-history sharpen the minds of nationalists, and are thus properly a subject rather than a method of national history. Voice and mode. The voice of myth-makers and meta-historians is earnest and confiding. Their claims depend upon what authors take to be self-evident. The voice of theorists of nationalism can be distant and ironic. They see that the apparently obvious is obviously mistaken, that the emperor has no clothes. The question is why naked emperors get to rule. Part of the answer is the deceptively soporific nature of irony. In the guise of vivifying exposure of contradiction, irony can confirm our slumbering misconceptions about how the world works. Since the experience of irony depends upon what we take for granted, our complacency is the ground on which it gains traction. If we treat irony as the moment for closure, we might mistakenly conclude from the examples to follow that nationality is invented, or accidental, or too confusing to categorize. It is ironic, perhaps, that a great Ukrainian activist of the 20th century, a Greek Catholic churchman, was raised in a Polish family and baptized a Roman Catholic. This irony should be seen as a proposal, that we consider the complexity of his native Galicia and the modern transformation of the early modern inheritance of the Commonwealth. It might also seem ironic that the most famous Polish statesman of the first half of the 20th century called himself a Lithuanian, or that the one line of poetry every Pole can recite is, "Lithuania, my fatherland." If we experience irony as an invitation to investigate, we find that variants of the early modern nationality of the Commonwealth survived its demise by more than a century. In this study, irony is a way to ask questions, not a substitute for answers. The nation is here neither an object of faith nor an object of fun, but an object of study. The chosen mode of expression is chronological historical narrative. This mode has been criticized, and rightly so, for its tendency to treat the nation as the literary protagonist of an epic of suffering, salvation, and such like. This introduction has proposed a topic about which, a period for which, a space in which, and a voice by which a critical narrative of national history might be written. Yet this has not been a defensive venture. Narrative history is indispensable to the important task of understanding nations and nationalism. Recent debates over theories of nationalism began from a handful of outstanding works of social science, all of them parasitical upon history. Parasitism has a bad name. What I mean is that social scientists discreetly consume historical narratives as they energetically analyze nationalism. As historiography lumbers forward to meet this challenge, parasitism becomes symbiosis. After all, the questions posed by the constructivist turn in the study of nationality require further historical research. And just as historical narrative can profit from sociological critique to gain distance from politics, so too can social science gain political perspective from history. Neither, after all, is innocent of political applications. There are people today with great vested interests in showing, for example, that Ukraine was the construction of Austrian, German, Polish, whatever, agents, just as others are committed to the view that an essentially continuous Ukrainian history justifies Ukrainian independence. After the Yugoslav wars, it is sometimes held that ethnic cleansers are motivated by essentialist views about blood and belonging. In fact, historical study reveals that the ones who matter employ a sophisticated constructivist view of nationality. The simple fact that nationality is a major foundation of political legitimacy implicates all of its students, and for that reason, among others, its study should be cooperative. To this enterprise, narrative offers chronology, comparison, and coherence, a historian's simple gifts. Yet how to tell, at the end of the day, if the historical narrative is critical? Conventional wisdom is like a sheet of ice, covering the dark sea of the undiscovered. Does the narrative flow like water over the smooth surface? Water takes the path of least resistance, yielding to gravity and then to the cold. It seals promising cracks as it freezes, in the end adding its own mass to the ice. It proves to be of the same matter as that with which it deals. Or does the narrative move more like an icebreaker, sailing under its own power, identifying problems and confronting them? Is it sharp in front? Does it welcome hard weather? Can it survive heavy blows? Does it leave in its wake a view of the deep, a black line through white ice, a passage that others may follow? Part 1. The Contested Lithuanian-Belarusian Fatherland. Chapter 1. The Grand Duchy of Lithuania, 1569 to 1863. Lithuania, my fatherland, you are like health. Only he who has lost you may know your true worth. Adam Mickiewicz, Pan Tadeusz, 1834, Paris. Once upon a time, the Grand Duchy of Lithuania dominated medieval Eastern Europe. Since 1991, the Republic of Lithuania has been a small country on the Baltic Sea. Vilnius, once the capital of the Grand Duchy, is today the capital of the Republic. The apparent continuity conceals tremendous change. For half a millennium before 1991, Lithuanian was neither the language of power in Vilnius nor the language spoken by most of its inhabitants. Before the Second World War, the language spoken in a third of its homes was Yiddish. The language of its streets, churches, and schools was Polish. And the language of its countryside was Belarusian. In 1939, almost no one spoke Lithuanian in Vilnius. In that year, the city was seized from Poland by the Soviet Union. How, then, did Lithuania come to mean what it does today, a small independent nation-state with Vilnius as its capital? How did the past matter, if it mattered at all? The present may be understood in terms of closed possibilities. From the middle of the 16th until the middle of the 20th century, the city was a center of Polish and Jewish civilization. Before it became a modern Lithuanian city, Vilnius ceased to be Polish and Jewish. Vilnius was once the capital of a great multinational realm. For it to become the capital of a small state, modern proposals to revive the old Grand Duchy as a federation had to be defeated. The city also did not become Russian, despite being ruled from Moscow and St. Petersburg for most of the past 200 years, nor Belarusian, despite the preponderance of East Slavic peasants in the countryside. A modern Lithuanian idea based upon history and language was victorious in Vilnius, even though we see that history and language themselves had little to offer Lithuanian nationalists who dreamed of the city. How does modern nationalism recover territory in such conditions? Why one modern nationalism rather than another? Present national ideas arose in intimate contact with past rivals. Assertions of continuity and justice, mainstays of the national histories of established states, were once weapons in fierce and uncertain contests. The next five chapters discuss the fate of Vilnius not only in terms of Lithuanian success, but in light of the aims and plans of the city's Poles, Belarusians, Russians, and Jews. Henceforth, the capital of the old Grand Duchy will be called by the name the aspirant or inhabitant attaches to it: Vilnius for Lithuanians, Vilno for Poles, Vilnia for Belarusians, Vilna for Jews, Vilno, then Vilna, then Vilnias for Russians. This nominal pluralism may appear awkward at first, but it allows us to see political disputes and awakens our skepticism to settled facts of geography. In this way, we may see competing ideas, movements, and states for what they were, stages in the reconstruction of the elite early modern nation of the Grand Duchy into new modern nations. To avoid seeing these developments as inevitable, we shall concentrate on twists and turns, on contingencies, on misunderstandings, on unintended consequences. We shall attend to the successes and to the failures. Nothing is simple in the relationship between national ideas and political power. Different parts of a society subscribe to different forms of national loyalty, and these differences may prevent consensus on crucial questions. National ideas have a force of their own and can be put to political use by calculating outsiders. National ideas arise in circumstances other than those when they gain force. When true to tradition, they prove unwieldy in practice. When innovative, they awkwardly call for change in the name of continuity. The more effective national ideas involve getting the past wrong. To understand their power to bring about the change they conceal, we must get the past right. Our goal is not to correct national myths, but to reveal the political and social conditions under which they gained life and force. This chapter and the next will help us to see the novelty of modern national ideas of Lithuania, Belarus, and Poland by defining the early modern nationality that preceded them. To get a sense of the legacies bequeathed to modern national activists in the 20th century, we must consider the medieval Grand Duchy of Lithuania and the early modern Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. The modern competition for Vilnius grew from an earlier idea of nationhood within historical Lithuania. The Grand Duchy of Lithuania, 1385 to 1795. Lithuanian Grand Dukes were the great warlords of 13th and 14th century Europe. They conquered a vast dominion, ranging from native Baltic lands southward through the East Slavic heartland to the Black Sea. Picking up the pieces left by the Mongol invasion of Kievan Rus, the pagan Lithuanians incorporated most of the territories of this early East Slavic realm. The Orthodox boyars of Rus, accustomed to Mongol overlordship, could regard Lithuania not as conqueror, but as ally. As Lithuanian military power flowed south, to Kiev, so the civilization of Rus, Orthodox religion, Church Slavonic language, and mature legal tradition, flowed north to Vilnius. As Vilnius replaced Kiev as the center of Orthodox Slavic civilization, two Catholic powers, the crusading Teutonic Knights and the Polish Kingdom, aspired to Lithuanian territories. Pagan Lithuanian Grand Dukes astutely bargained for their baptism. In the late 14th century, Lithuanian Grand Duke Jogaila traded Catholic conversion for the Polish crown. Polish nobles, keen to avoid a Habsburg on the throne, offered Jogaila 11-year-old Princess Jadwiga, and with her the Polish succession. Jogaila, as Grand Duke of Lithuania and Lord and Heir of Rus, Dux Magnus Litvanorum Rusiaeque Dominus et Aerus Naturalis, accepted a merger of his domains with Poland at Krewa in 1385. He was baptized as Władysław Jagiełło and elected King of Poland the next year. Successive agreements preserved the personal union by restoring Lithuanian autonomy and linking the Polish and Lithuanian nobility. The Jagiełło dynasty ruled both Poland and Lithuania for almost two centuries, until 1572. Even before the Krewa Union of 1385, Lithuania was in religion and in language rather an Orthodox Slavic than a pagan Baltic country. Jogaila's promise of conversion to Catholic Christianity applied to himself and remaining pagans. Most of his realm, and many of his relatives, were already Orthodox Christians. The result of Jogaila's conversion was not so much the Christianization of a pagan country, as the introduction of Roman Catholicism into a largely Orthodox country. The introduction of Catholicism established a cultural link between Lithuania and Europe and created the potential for Polish influence. The baptism of the Lithuanian Grand Duke as a Catholic ensured that Lithuania was not an Orthodox state in the sense that Muscovy was being established as one. By the same token, Jogaila's baptism opened the way for Muscovy to pose as the protector of Orthodoxy. By the time Lithuania had incorporated Kiev, the Orthodox Metropolitan had vacated the city for Vladimir on the Kliasma. The Metropolitan's subsequent residence in Muscovy complicated Lithuania's claim to be the successor of Rus. Jogaila did have the opportunity to resolve this tension, since in the 1380s he had a choice between Catholic Poland and Orthodox Muscovy. In 1382, he went so far as to agree to marry the daughter of Dmitry Donskoy and accept Orthodoxy. This plan had two disadvantages. Orthodoxy would not defend Lithuania from the Teutonic Knights, who treated it as heresy, and Orthodoxy would favor the Slavic boyars in Lithuania, already more numerous and more cultured than Jogaila's Baltic-Lithuanian dynasty. The Polish crown and Catholic cross were favorable in both domestic and international policy. They provided a reliable bulwark against the Teutonic Knights, a reliable basis for expansion to the east, and a new source of distinction for Jagiełło and his descendants. Politics aside, medieval Poland and Lithuania had more in common than one might suppose. When we imagine Lithuanians and Poles negotiating the terms of their alliance in 1385, or planning the common assault on the Teutonic Knights at Grunwald in 1410, we must keep in mind that they could communicate not only in Latin, but also in Slavic languages. Local recensions of Church Slavonic, introduced by Orthodox churchmen from more southerly lands, provided the basis for Chancery Slavonic, the court language of the Grand Duchy. Having annexed Galicia, a former province of Kievan Rus known in Poland as the Rus Palatinate, Voivodstvo Ruski, Poland also had its share of Orthodox churchmen and Church Slavonic scribes. Having divided the lands of Kievan Rus, Poland and Lithuania shared its cultural inheritances. Poles and Lithuanians were not divided by language to the same extent as were contemporary Poles and Germans. After 1386, the Polish-Lithuanian courts functioned in Latin and in two distinct Slavic languages, the Polish of the Polish Kingdom and the Chancery Slavonic of the Grand Duchy. Lithuanian continued to be a spoken language of the Lithuanian Grand Dukes and their entourage for another century, but in the politics of Poland-Lithuania, its role was minor. In the next chapter, we shall learn that the Baltic-Lithuanian language provided the basis for a modern Lithuanian nation. Here, we must a fortiori record its irrelevance in the early modern Grand Duchy of Lithuania. The last Grand Duke to know the Lithuanian language was apparently Kazimierz IV, who died in 1492. When Kazimierz IV confirmed the privileges of Lithuania in 1457, he did so in Latin and Chancery Slavonic. When he issued law codes for the realm, he did so in Chancery Slavonic. During Kazimierz's reign, the printing press was introduced in Poland. Krakow publishers published books in Polish and Church Slavonic, but not in Lithuanian. Franciszek Skarina, the first printer of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, published much of the Bible around 1517 in a Belarusian recension of Church Slavonic. In the early 16th century, we also find biblical translations into the Slavic vernacular, Ruthenian, though not in the Baltic vernacular, Lithuanian. Unlike Skarina, these involved direct translations of the Old Testament from the Hebrew. These Old Testament translations were apparently executed by Lithuanian Jews who knew Hebrew and spoke Ruthenian. Since Ruthenian was spoken by local Christians and Jews in the early 16th century, intended readers may have been Christians, Jews, or both. One confirmation of the privileges of the Jews of Lithuania was issued in the year 1972. The year 7022/1514, reckoned in both Eastern and Western Christian fashion, dating a decree in Chancery Slavonic of the King of Poland and Grand Duke of Lithuania. The Grand Duchy's Statute of 1529 was composed in Chancery Slavonic. The statute was interpreted by Grand Duke and King Zygmunt August in his replies to the Lithuanian gentry in Vilnia in the 1540s in a Chancery Slavonic riddled with Polish. In Muscovy, the state language of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, which we are calling Chancery Slavonic, was called Lithuanian or Belarusian. Although modern Russian historians sometimes call this language Russian, at the time, Muscovite scribes had to translate the Lithuanian statutes into Moscow dialect for them to be of use to their court. Chancery Slavonic differed significantly from contemporary Polish, but in the context of dynastic union with Poland, it provided a Slavic platform for the spread of the Polish language and ideas. As early as 1501, legal texts in Chancery Slavonic are penetrated by Polish terms and even Polish grammar. The introduction to the Grand Duchy's 1566 statute records that the Lithuanian gentry was already using Polish in practice. The acts of the 1569 Lublin Union, which created the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, were recorded in Polish only. The position of the Polish language in Lithuania was not the result of Polish immigration, but rather of the gradual acceptance of a political order developed in Poland and codified for a new Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth in 1569. That this was matter of political culture rather than of personal origin is emphasized by the Grand Duchy's 1588 statute, which ennobled Jewish converts to Christianity. Poland also served to communicate larger trends in European law. Whereas the medieval appropriation of Roman law never reached Muscovy, the statutes of 1566 and 1588 demonstrate the growing importance of Roman and Germanic models in Lithuania. During the Renaissance, much of what was conveyed to Poland from Italy in Latin was conveyed from Poland to Lithuania in Polish. As the Polish vernacular was elevated to the status of a literary language in Poland, it superseded Chancery Slavonic and vernacular Ruthenian in Lithuania. The Polish and Lithuanian nobility came to share a language during the Renaissance, facilitating the creation of a single early modern political nation. That said, there was a pregnant difference between the Latin to Polish shift in Poland and the Chancery Slavonic to Polish shift in Lithuania. In the Polish kingdom, the vernacular, Polish, dethroned an imported literary language, Latin. The elevation of Polish to equal status with Latin was an example of a general trend within Latin Europe, which began with the Italian language question. In the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, an import, Polish, supplanted the native language of politics and law, Chancery Slavonic, and forestalled the further literary use of the local vernacular, Ruthenian. As we have seen, the Baltic-Lithuanian language had lost its political importance long before. The Renaissance language question was thus answered in an unusual way in Lithuania. In Italy, after Dante, and then throughout Christian Europe, the vernacular was elevated to a language of literature and state. The Grand Duchy of Lithuania became a country in which the language of culture and politics was further from, rather than closer to, the vernacular. Polish as common high language well met the needs of the republican institutions and ideals of early modern Poland-Lithuania. It would not withstand the advent of modern democratic national ideas that bore these same names. Early modern and modern nations. In pointing to legacies of early modern politics to modern politics, we must be clear about the differences. The early modern Polish nation, which the Lithuanian gentry jointly created, was far from the modern concept of the nation with which we are familiar. It was based on citizenship in a great republic, where the gentry enjoyed extensive and codified rights. By the early 16th century, the Polish gentry had secured for itself protections against arbitrary action by the king, a major role in the conduct of foreign affairs, and the right to reject new legislation. The increasingly constitutional basis of the Polish polity allowed for the lasting inclusion of units with distinct traditions of local rights, such as Royal Prussia. By the same token, the Polish system created a model for neighboring gentry who wished to formalize and extend their own privileges. In deciding upon a constitutional union with Poland, Lithuania's gentry were pursuing such rights, privileges, and protections for themselves. During the period of dynastic union with Poland, Lithuania became an East Slavic realm in which the gentry enjoyed rights relative to the sovereign. By the terms of the 1569 Lublin Union, Lithuanian nobles joined their Polish neighbors in a single parliament and in the common election of kings. Lithuania preserved its own title, administration, treasury, code of law, and army. The Commonwealth thereby created was a republic of the gentry, whose myth of Sarmatian origin included nobles of various origins and religions and excluded everyone else. After 1569, the Polish identity of Lithuanian gentry was increasingly a matter of culture as well as politics, involving sometimes acceptance of the Renaissance charms of Polish letters, sometimes conversion from Eastern Orthodoxy to Roman Catholicism. The Reformation and Counter-Reformation followed a special trajectory in the Grand Duchy. Like aristocratic families across Europe, much of the Lithuanian gentry converted to Calvinism in the 1550s and 1560s. Orthodox converts were drawn to Protestantism not only by its methods and doctrines, but by its similarity to the Eastern Church in matters of practice. The marriage of clergy, the use of the vernacular in liturgy, and the chalice for laymen. Unlike nobles in Germany or France, who converted from one variety of Western Christianity to another, Lithuanian nobles usually partook in reform by converting from Eastern to Western Christianity. After a single generation as Protestants, formerly Orthodox Lithuanian families usually converted to the Roman Catholicism. In this way, Protestantism proved to be the unwitting ally of Catholicism in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. It was not Catholicism itself, but reform which drew Orthodox Lithuanian nobles to accept Western Christianity, first in its Protestant and then in its Catholic form. Of course, Counter-Reformation Catholicism adopted the tactics of its Protestant rivals. Its use of Polish as the vernacular, although Catholics published a few books in Lithuanian as well, reinforced the prestige of Polish culture among the Lithuanian nobility, and its new proselytism brought the Lithuanian-speaking peasantry into contact with the Polish language. The Jesuits opened an academy in Vilno in 1579. Their propaganda against Protestantism could not be separated from their appeals to the Orthodox to accept the authority of Rome. Although Roman Catholicism was known as the Polish faith, even after the Counter-Reformation, the Polish faith was by no means necessary for Polish political loyalty. Like language, religion would be retrospectively understood by later nationalists as a marker or a carrier of national identity. Yet there had been no religious strife to force territorial resolutions on the German principle of cuius regiu, eius religio, nor to suggest the French solution of un roi, une foi, une loi. The Grand Duchy's 1566 statute was written by a committee of 5 Orthodox and 5 Catholics. Augustin Rotundus, a Polish participant in the Counter-Reformation in Lithuania, was a friend of Mikołaj Radziwiłł, the Black, 1515-65, a Palatine of Vilno and the main Lithuanian propagator of the Reformation, first in its Lutheran, then in its Calvinist, and finally in its anti-Trinitarian forms. Rotundus, Pole and Catholic, wrote a long defense of Lithuanian law, which Radziwiłł, Lithuanian and Protestant, published. Rotundus also edited and translated the 1566 Lithuanian statute into Latin. Rotundus agreed with Radziwiłł that Lithuania was a respublica bene ordinata. Piotr Skarga, 1536-1612, the greatest of the Polish Jesuits, dedicated the 1577 edition of his greatest work to the Orthodox Palatine of Kyiv, Prince Konstantin Ostrowski. In that case, the accord was less charming. Ostrowski, a proud and ambitious man who wanted church union on his own terms, bought up and burned the edition. The Commonwealth's political order was predicated not only on toleration of varieties of Western Christianity, but upon toleration of Eastern Christianity as well. Religious toleration for the entire body of the Christian nobility was established by the 1573 Confederation of Warsaw. Although toleration of varieties of Christian faith within a limited sphere of society may seem like intolerance to our sensibilities, the Confederation of Warsaw had no parallel in the Europe of the time. Early modern ideas of the Polish nation were at once more exclusive and more inclusive than the modern nationalisms which would succeed them. They were more exclusive, for while modern nationalism enlists all members of the putative nation, early modern Polish nationality distinguished a voting political estate from disenfranchised lower orders. The early modern nation was not an economic class. Magnates were always nobles, but very few nobles were magnates. Rich burghers were not citizens unless they were ennobled. The early modern nation was more inclusive than the modern nation in political terms, for while modern nationalism demands a centralized state, the Commonwealth retained separate Polish and Lithuanian law codes and administrations. The early modern nation was more inclusive in personal terms, for while modern nationalism tends to insist that national identity subsumes cultural origin and political destiny, early modern Polish identity presumed that gentry could be of one cultural affinity and of another political loyalty. Both the exclusivity and the inclusivity are reflected in the attitude to language. It was thought normal that a noble would use one language, Polish, with his peers or in politics, and another, what we would now call Belarusian or Lithuanian, in his household or with his serfs. A nobleman could be Lithuanian by origin, Polish in politics, and Russian, or Greek, by religion. Since Lithuania for a very long time included a majority of Orthodox subjects and most of the Kievan patrimony, it was called a Russian realm. In unifying his domains with Poland in 1385, Jogaila acted as Grand Duke of Lithuania and Lord and Heir of Rus. In a 1449 treaty between Poland-Lithuania and Muscovy, the former was called Russian, the latter Muscovite. After the fall of Constantinople to the Turks in 1453, Muscovy espoused spiritual and political claims as the seat of Orthodoxy, the heir of Byzantium, and the successor of Kievan Rus. These provided the justification for Muscovy's wars with their fellow East Slavs of Lithuania, whose grand dukes had regarded themselves for a century as the successors of Kievan princes. In practice, Muscovy's claim to be Rus pushed Lithuania toward Poland. When Ivan IV, the Terrible, reigned 1530 to 1584, proclaimed Tsar 1547, began the Livonian Wars in 1558, he hastened the Polish-Lithuanian Union of 1569. At that time, of course, Poland-Lithuania also claimed to be Rus. Zygmunt August's titles, as listed in the Privilege of 1569, were King of Poland, Grand Duke of Lithuania, Lord and Heir of Rus, Prussia, Mazovia, Samogitia, etc. Król Polski, Wielki Książę, Litewski, Ruski, Pruski, Mazowiecki, Żmudzki, i tak dalej, pan i dziedzic. Ivan's treatment of boyar rivals also provided the telling contrast to the rights Lithuanian nobles formalized under Zygmunt August that same year. Although the Commonwealth enjoyed great successes in the wars with Muscovy of the 17th century, and King Jan Sobieski's famous rescue of Vienna from the Turks in 1683 brought glory to Poland, the 18th century witnessed failure after failure. As we shall hear in Chapter 6, rebellion in Ukraine fatally wounded the Commonwealth in the middle of the 17th century. The Commonwealth failed to establish the fiscal or military bases of modern power. After some initial good luck, the election of monarchs ill served the interests of the Commonwealth. Kings who could not establish dynasties were less willing to consider the welfare of the Commonwealth, and kings of foreign origin were less likely to immerse themselves in the difficulties of Polish politics. The expansive rights of Polish and Lithuanian gentry even provided the Russian Empire, as Muscovy was called after 1721, with a way to hamstring the Commonwealth's polity. Since the Commonwealth's parliament functioned according to the principle of unanimity, one bribe was enough to prevent any reform. Tsar Peter I, the Great, ruled 1682 to 1725, reached the Baltic and corrupted the Commonwealth. Polish anarchy was exploited by Muscovite despotism. Yet even as the Commonwealth disintegrated as a state in the 18th century, and as its cherished principles of toleration eroded, Polish civilization further penetrated the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. What was once a sign of nobility became a sign of status, and thus Polishness flourished in Lithuania throughout the 18th century, and indeed long after the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth was naught but a memory. The Commonwealth's culture evolved as its institutions failed to adapt. The first partition of the Commonwealth by Austria, Prussia, and Russia was executed in 1772. The final attempt of the Polish-Lithuanian nobility to repair the Commonwealth's institutions was the Constitution of the 3rd of May, 1791. This constitution treated the Polish-Lithuanian nobility as a single political nation, did away with principle of unanimity in parliamentary voting, and sought to create a modern centralized republic. This provoked the second partition by Prussia and Russia in 1793. The 1794 Kosciuszko uprising against Russia was defeated and was followed by the third and final partition in 1795. The Commonwealth had been removed from the map of Europe. The Russian Empire of Tsaritsa Catherine II, the Great, ruled 1762 to 96, progressively annexed almost all of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. The city of Polotsk in 1772, Minsk in 1774, and finally Vilno in 1795. By incorporating Lithuania, Russia absorbed elites who spoke Polish, peasants who spoke, for the most part, what we would now call Belarusian, and towns inhabited in the main by Jews. The end of the Commonwealth meant the end of a political regime where, despite local prejudice, the Jews enjoyed an institutionalized regime of communal toleration. At a stroke, Russia held the largest part of world Jewry. After the Russian share of the old Commonwealth was enlarged to include Warsaw at the Congress of Vienna, 1815, the empire included most of the world's Poles. From the Grand Duchy of Lithuania alone, to speak neither of what was established as the Congress Kingdom of Poland nor of Ukraine, Russia absorbed more nobles of Polish culture than there were nobles of Russian culture in the entire Russian Empire. In the early 19th century, far more subjects of the Tsar could read Polish than Russian. Some Polish-Lithuanian nobles, such as Prince Adam Czartoryski, attained enormous influence in the court of Tsar Alexander I, ruled 1801 to 25. Czartoryski, for example, was partially responsible for the terms of the Russian Empire's 1804 Jewish statute. The destruction of the Commonwealth and the concomitant establishment of the Pale of Settlement in Russia were accompanied by radical attempts to reform Judaism and Jewish social practice. We shall return to these in Chapter 3. Here we may only note that they involved historical myths that were not territorial, as in Hasidism, which arose in Ukraine after the death of the Baal Shem Tov in 1760, or trends that were pan-European, as in the Haskalah, the Jewish Enlightenment. These trends, though they met at Vilna, were something other than a variant of the traditions of the Grand Duchy. Only at the end of the 19th century did something like secular Jewish politics arise. Among the Tsar's Christian subjects, the early modern gentry nation was slowly and partially replaced by modern conceptions of the nation as the sum of speakers of a vernacular tongue. The 19th century national divergence among Christians in Lithuania was a long and complicated process, itself denying the crisp retrospective categorizations of the modern nationalists it produced. A prism through which to observe the refraction of early modern Lithuanian patriotism into distinctly colored national ideas is a poem, Pan Tadeusz, or Lord Thaddeus, completed by the great Romantic poet Adam Mickiewicz in 1834. Russian Empire and Lithuanian Fatherland. Mickiewicz, 1798 to 1855, was born on Christmas Eve, 3 years after the final partition of the Commonwealth, in Novogródek, a Yiddish and Polish-speaking town. The local Lithuanian Tatars had just built a new mosque. Although there were Lithuanian villages nearby, most local peasants spoke Belarusian. Mickiewicz was raised by an upstanding Polish gentry family, although his father was probably of Orthodox and his mother perhaps of Jewish descent. Mickiewicz attended the Imperial University at Vilno, an institution that nicely illustrates the dilemma of an illiterate empire that has absorbed large numbers of literate families. In the early 19th century, Russian policy aimed to preserve educational attainment in Polish rather than Russify potentially useful subjects. In 1803, Tsar Alexander I, ruled 1801-25, had revived the Vilno School, founded by the Jesuits in 1579, as a university, with Polish as the language of instruction. The university and the entire Vilno school district were directed by Tsar Alexander's friend, advisor, and mentor, the Polish-Lithuanian prince Adam Czartoryski, 1770-1861. Vilno University, an inheritance of the Commonwealth, was the largest university in the Russian Empire. For a full generation, it confirmed local elites, such as Mickiewicz, in their belief that the language of culture and politics was Polish. The university and its associated schools educated men who codified in history, literature, and poetry the legacy of the recently defunct Grand Duchy of Lithuania. Incidentally, for a time, Czartoryski's secretary and his immediate superior were both Ukrainians. Just as the partitions brought Poles into Russian service in the late 18th century, so a century earlier the partition of Ukraine by the Treaty of Andrusova had brought in Ukrainians. Without a university education in his native Polish, in his native Lithuania, Mickiewicz's poetic career is difficult to imagine. This can be seen clearly on the example of his masterpiece, Pan Tadeusz, which Mickiewicz finished in Parisian exile in 1834. Its story of the quarrels and loves of Lithuanian gentry families concludes in spring 1812, as Napoleon and his armies marched across Lithuania toward Moscow. In the poem, Lithuanian noblemen have joined the French armies, which was certainly accurate. Mickiewicz observed this himself as a boy of 13. In fact, the gentry who joined Napoleon in 1812 included a third of the students of Vilno University. Tsar Alexander won the war. When Alexander regained Lithuania, he declined to close Vilno University, so its gates were opened to Mickiewicz in 1815. Registering as a student with a government scholarship, the young man even gave his name as Adam Napoleon Mickiewicz. The patience of a Russian Tsar, after his empire was attacked by the Lithuanian gentry his university was educating, allowed Mickiewicz to gain higher education in Polish. Mickiewicz then matured to create a nostalgic masterpiece that connected the tragedy of Poland with that very attack on Russia. At the time of Mickiewicz's university studies, Polish Lithuanians presumed that the inevitable Lithuanian revival would hasten a new Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. The putative enemy of this idea was not rival nationalisms, which did not then exist, but the imperial Russian state. These motives of renewal animated Mickiewicz and his student friends, who called themselves the Philomaths. After graduation, Mickiewicz was rescued from the drudgery of teaching school in Kovno by arrest, imprisonment, and exile in Russia. His years in exile in Odessa, Petersburg, and Moscow, and then in emigration in Dresden and Paris, were fantastically productive of the best Polish poetry yet written. Mickiewicz did not join the Polish rising against Russian rule of 1830-31. The failure of which began the Romantic period of Polish political thought. It also led directly to the closing of Vilno University. The university's students lived on in Lithuania, in Poland, in Russia, and in Europe. Mickiewicz's own poetry was composed in a harmony of human and national longing. The Commonwealth would not be restored, and he never again saw his native Lithuania. His masterpiece, Pan Tadeusz, was written between 1832 and 1834, immediately after the Rising had been crushed. As every Polish and Lithuanian schoolchild knows, the poem begins, "Lithuania, my fatherland, you are like health. Only he who has lost you may know your true worth." Since his creations proved so adaptable to succeeding ages, Mickiewicz must be placed in his own time. Like other European romantics, Mickiewicz wished to create a new world on the ruins of the old. For romantics in Western and Central Europe, the French Revolution and Napoleon had destroyed classical Europe, and the task was to establish new political and cultural principles. For Mickiewicz and the Polish romantics, the partitions of Poland had destroyed the old order, and the French Revolution and Napoleon had provided some hope that it might be restored. After Napoleon's defeat, the gentry of the Grand Duchy had no possible allies but the peasants who surrounded them, and Mickiewicz's poetic romanticism created a political dilemma. Whereas it was relatively simple for romantics of other stateless nations, such as Italy or Germany, to conflate the common people with the rising political nation, in historic Lithuania the matter was far more complicated. The Herderian idea that each people had its own distinct genius was hard to apply in a region where various localities, languages, and religions had long been held compatible with membership in a single political nation. The problem lay not only in variety of culture, but in living memory of political institutions. In the middle of the 19th century, the idea of unified Germany or Italy left plenty of room for the imagination, since no such entities had existed before. The idea of a unified Poland automatically raised the specter of the recently defunct Commonwealth, the more so as the Commonwealth had promulgated Europe's first constitution just before its demise. In Mickiewicz's vision, Lithuania was at once part of this political tradition and home to romantic virtues such as harmony, beauty, energy, and pleasure. Whereas Herder had believed that Slavs might bring youth and energy to Europe, Mickiewicz believed that Lithuania would revive the entire Commonwealth. Mickiewicz's early modern idea of Lithuania as a land of many peoples but of an ultimately Polish destiny suffered the contradictions imminent in durability in a century when the sense of nationality radically changed. Although he was not himself a folkish Polish nationalist, and never set foot in Warsaw or Krakow, his lovely poetry created the medium for a folkish Polish nationalism after his death in 1855. Although he never imagined a Lithuania separate from Poland, his images were used by Lithuanian activists ever more confident in their distinct ethnic and national identity. In the late 19th century, in the northwestern corner of the former Grand Duchy, the Lithuanian language provided the basis for a cultural distinctiveness that new national activists of an ethnic Lithuania would eventually exploit. This involved transforming Mickiewicz into a Lithuanian national poet. Ironically, the ethnic definition of nationality that emerged in central Poland and northwestern Lithuania, if a good description of historical trends, would have made Mickiewicz neither Polish nor Lithuanian, but Belarusian. After all, Mickiewicz was born, and Pan Tadeusz was set, among East Slavic peasants we would now call Belarusians. Perhaps it is more ironic still that the Belarusian gentry and writers were most faithful to Mickiewicz, and did not seize upon their ethnic advantages by making exclusivist claims upon him as a national poet. A modern ethnic nationalism that encompassed Mickiewicz's Lithuania, the old Grand Duchy, would have been based upon the majority language, dialects we would now call Belarusian. This is what did not happen. Ethnic nationalism is a political idea, and its success or failure has little to do with the size of what we now see as ethnic groups. As we shall argue in the next chapter, politics granted the greatest possibilities to interpretations of Pan Tadeusz that were furthest in spirit from the original, Lithuanian and Polish ethnic nationalism, and marginalized its most faithful translations into politics, Belarusian and Polish federalism. The test of early modern Lithuanian patriotism as articulated by Mickiewicz was the 1863 rising against Russian rule. Certain exceptional people believed that the Grand Duchy and the Commonwealth could be revived by way of an alliance of the Polish-speaking gentry with the Lithuanian or Belarusian-speaking peasantry. Between the Russian defeat in the Crimean War, 1856, and Tsar Alexander II's abolition of serfdom, 1861, some Lithuanian-Polish nobles had conspired to resolve the question of serfdom in a way that would satisfy landlords and peasants. Jakub Geisztor, 1827-97, campaigned to convince Lithuanian nobles to free their peasants before the Tsar did. Although Geisztor was successful in his locality, in Lithuania as a whole, the gentry missed the opportunity to take credit for the inevitable. Geisztor, who thought himself a Polish noble building an alliance with the Polish people, ran a school in which Lithuanian was the language of instruction. He saw no contradiction. In the 1863 rising against Russian rule, which he had opposed as premature, Geisztor conspired with the radical Konstanty Kolonowski, Kastus Kolonowski, 1838-64. During the rising, Kolonowski promised peasants land in their own language, Belarusian. Antanas Maskavicius, although now seen as a proto-Lithuanian nationalist, fought to re-establish the Grand Duchy of Lithuania in a provisional association with Poland. In 1863, all three sought to persuade peasants to fight for their own good, without really believing that peasants understood the importance of restoring the republic. These and other leaders of 1863 were no longer early modern patriots keen to restore a gentry republic, but they were not yet modern nationalists, fully prepared to define the nation as the people. Their attempt to defeat the Russian Empire with the help of the people revealed two incipient dilemmas. The use of languages other than Polish foreshadowed a new type of national politics. If peasants could be called to risk their lives in their own languages, surely they would expect to hear and read those languages in calmer times as well. The nobles' need to give land to the peasants to gain their support posed a hard choice between personal security and national liberation. Mickiewicz's nostalgia after the failure of 1830 was for an early modern political nation. What emerged after the failure of 1863 were modern national ideas. Chapter 2. Lithuania, My Fatherland, 1863-1914. As butterflies drown in golden amber, let us remain, dear, as we once were. Adam Mickiewicz, Konrad Wallenrod, St. Petersburg, 1828. Modern politics after 1863 meant shrugging off the Commonwealth as a burden and embracing the peasant and his language as the nation. The first became clear in the extreme northwest of the old Grand Duchy of Lithuania, where the failure of the 1863 uprising hastened a modern linguistic Lithuanian nationalism. The drastic nature of peasant emancipation accelerated.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.